Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Rise and Decline of Nations, Economic Growth, Stagflation, and Social Rigidities by Mancur Olson. Introduction by Edward L. Glazer. Narrated by William Sarris. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to tables and figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction to the Veritas Paperback Edition. Edward L. Glazer. Mancur Olson's The Rise and Decline of Nations depicts a process by which peaceful prosperity leads to the formation of distributional coalitions that enrich themselves by increasing the complexity of regulation, the role of government, and the complexity of understandings. These changes then slow down a society's capacity to adopt new technologies and to reallocate resources in response to changing conditions and thereby reduce the rate of economic growth. Peaceful prosperity leads to the emergence of interest groups, which use the tools of government for their own ends. Ultimately, their efforts stifle economic dynamism and destroy the prosperity that brought them into being. This progression can be called an Olson cycle, and we should worry about being caught in its turns. The book's message has grown increasingly important because America, and most of the wealthy world, has evolved in exactly the manner that Olson predicted. Interest groups, such as homeowners who block new construction and retirees who oppose any cost-saving reform of Medicare, have become ever more entrenched. Regulations that protect insiders, such as occupational licensing requirements for interior decorators and florists, have proliferated. New business formation plummeted between the 1980s and the 2010s. The American economy has grown much less since 1980 than it did before that date. I first read The Rise and Decline of Nations in 1993. After receiving a kind letter from Olson in response to a paper that I co-wrote, finding that industrial clusters with many small firms grew much more quickly than clusters dominated by a few large enterprises. After reading his book, I agreed that our evidence supported Olson's view that large, organized entities often manage to stifle competition, which ultimately harms growth. But I failed to grasp the larger importance of his work. I had no argument with the core elements in Olson's logic. He was surely right that stable societies with unchanged boundaries tend to accumulate more collusions and organizations for collective action over time. These interest groups are often harmful. On balance, special interest organizations and collusions reduce efficiency and aggregate income in the societies in which they operate and make political life more divisive. While I accepted that this process might be occurring, I was skeptical of Olson's view that the accumulation of distributional coalitions actually determines the fate of nations. His ideas just didn't seem all that relevant in post-Reagan America. Olson may have accurately described the United Kingdom during its strife-strewn winter of discontent, 1978-79, but it felt like mourning in America. Under Carter and Alfred Kahn, we had rolled back the regulation of transportation. Reagan then required that all new federal regulation go through cost-benefit analysis. Tax rates had been cut. Our economy seemed to be enormously flexible as it shifted from manufacturing to services. In the 10 years following January 1981, total service employment exploded by 28%, adding 19 million new jobs. As Olson's faultless logic didn't seem applicable to the United States, it didn't challenge my broad faith in the economic orthodoxy that growth is largely driven by technological change and the accumulation of factors such as human and physical capital. 30 years later, Olson seems prescient, and I seem naive. I returned to Olson after studying the land use regulations that limit the growth of America's most productive regions, including Silicon Valley, ensuring that property values in these places are exorbitant. The prosperous homeowners, who lobby against every new development and enact even tougher rules, seemed a perfect example of Olson's distributional coalitions. As the 2000s turned into the 2010s, America appeared to be responding sluggishly to major shocks, such as the Great Recession and the flood of Chinese imports, the latter referred to as the China Shock by author Dorn and Hansen. Our public sector seems similarly sclerotic, as 25 years of public school reform has done little to improve the plight of poor urban children. If you share any part of my view that America often seems to coddle insiders and ignore outsiders, then you should keep on listening. Olson foresaw that outcome. Even if the rise and decline of nations offers no quick fixes for the problem, it provides a particularly clear-eyed analysis. Surely, that's the right place to start. The Rise of Mancur Olson. Mancur Olson's life provides a perfect example of how mid-20th century America enabled outsiders to rise into the upper reaches of the establishment. Olson was born in 1932 in Grand Forks, North Dakota, a remote rural town with fewer than 20,000 inhabitants. Olson's parents were Norwegian immigrant farmers. Upward mobility during these years was enabled by public investments in educational institutions such as the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks and North Dakota Agricultural College, where Olson received his bachelor's degree. Olson's economic excellence and bubbling enthusiasm for ideas propelled him out of obscurity in North Dakota. He was awarded a Rhodes Scholarship to study at Oxford. He received his Ph.D. in economics from Harvard in 1963 and joined Princeton as an assistant professor. Within 4 years, he was the Deputy Assistant Secretary of the U.S. Department of Health, Education, and Welfare. By that time, he had also published his first masterwork, The Logic of Collective Action. That book, a true intellectual behemoth, has influenced political science, economics, and sociology. Economics is the study of systems and shows how the interaction of individuals often produces results that are radically different from the objectives of those individuals. Adam Smith used the metaphor of an invisible hand to describe how people in markets, in spite of their natural selfishness and rapacity, without intending it, without knowing it, advance the interests of the society and afford means to the multiplication of the species. In his book Micromotives and Macrobehavior, Thomas Schelling, who was Olson's advisor, explained how groups can often produce less than the sum of their parts. Individuals who desire integration but prefer not to be in a minority in their own communities can adjust their locations in ways that produce completely segregated cities. Olson's The Logic of Collective Action focused on the gap between private incentives and collective behavior. He began by noting that it is often taken for granted, at least where economic objectives are involved, that groups of individuals with common interests usually attempt to further those interests. Karl Marx is a particularly prominent promulgator of the view that social classes, like the bourgeoisie, coherently advance their collective interests. Yet Olson grasped that his assumption was fundamentally flawed because free riding undermines collective efforts to promote class interests. Individual capitalists often put their own interests ahead of the interests of their industry or the larger interests of capitalism. 19th century scholars of monopoly and competition, such as Bertrand and Cournot, recognized that individual firms inevitably cut prices below monopoly levels to grab a larger market share. Olson brought this observation into the political realm. Just as it was not rational for a particular producer to restrict his output in order that there might be a higher price for the product of his industry, so it would not be rational for him to sacrifice his time and money to a lobbying organization to obtain government assistance for the industry. That observation then led Olson to focus on the conditions under which groups could effectively advance their interests. Smaller groups can be stronger than large groups because their coordination costs are lower and their free rider problems are more manageable. Organizations can successfully represent larger groups only if they have the power to restrict their benefits to their members. Unions succeed this way in closed-shop firms, which agree to hire union members only. Effective lobbying entities often thrive because of their ability to sell byproducts of their political activities, such as social connections or access to commerce with their members. In the 18 years between The Logic of Collective Action and The Rise and Decline of Nations, Olson moved to the University of Maryland and became a major figure among those public choice economists who thought about why governments did what they did. Political scientists generally viewed Olson more positively than they did other members of this group, such as James Buchanan and Gordon Tullock, perhaps because Olson seemed less dogmatic. His sunny enthusiasm also helped. Economists were somewhat less interested in The Logic of Collective Action because its focus on political outcomes made it less central to their and my field. The Rise and Decline of Nations, however, brought Olson's attention back to the heart of economics. In this book, Olson wasn't simply explaining why some industries lobbied more effectively than others. He was demonstrating why some economies thrived and some declined. His book illustrated why the American West was booming while New York City faced bankruptcy, and why post-war Germany grew rich while post-war Britain stagnated. He saw political forces looming large in the economic fate of nations, and he brought together a complete theory about how economics influences politics, and then how politics reciprocally influences economics. The Olson Cycle. What I will call an Olson cycle begins with a blank slate, occurring perhaps after a war or revolution has eviscerated most pre-existing interest groups. Germany after World War II, or Japan at the end of the warring 16th century, might fit these circumstances. If the initial political system contains the right sort of government, strong enough to protect life and property, but not so mighty that the whims of the sovereign can easily stifle trade and individual initiative, growth begins. Growing wealth then encourages political entrepreneurs to organize small, coherent interest groups and seek power. Businesses lobby the government for protective regulation. Workers create guilds and labor unions. Public sector employees form political machines to protect their perquisites. The essential ingredient leading to the success of these groups is that their benefits flow to a concentrated set of members, while their costs are imposed on society at large. Those costs are spread sufficiently wide to preclude sufficient public anger to stifle these efforts or create a backlash-based counter-movement. Individuals who don't benefit from one of the existing groups will find their political capital better directed by forming their own narrow interest group instead of fighting the existing interest groups. So far, economic growth and stability have begotten a political outcome, a proliferation of interest groups. Though they start weak, they strengthen as their concentrated benefits rise. Now the Olson cycle returns to economics. All of these groups create so many barriers to change that society inhibits entrepreneurship. Almost every new effort tramples on the toes of an established interest. The economy is no longer able to adapt to changing conditions. Olson illustrated his ideas by focusing on Edo period Japan, Britain in the 1970s, and the differing fortunes of places within the United States. He even presented state-level regressions compatible with his theory that early success leads to sclerosis and ultimately failure. America's regional evolutions supported his hypothesis in 1982, and they are almost incomprehensible in 2022 without his hypothesis. The Olson Cycle and American Decline. Writing in The Rise and Decline of Nations, Olson understood that America's older regions, such as the Northeast and the Midwest, were highly regulated and often dominated by established groups, including big businesses and unions. Newer regions, such as the West, were more open. Following the logic of the Olson cycle, these newer regions should grow more quickly than the older regions. Olson showed that the years since statehood were negatively associated with income growth and positively associated with union membership. The level of urbanization in 1880, another proxy for long-ago development, was also associated with sluggish growth after 1965. Olson also noted the faster growth of the South. The South is technically old, but Olson argued that the interest groups of the South were torn apart by the Civil War, and then, in the 20th century, the old pattern of coalitions in the South was eventually emasculated by the New Deal and post-war federal policies, by cosmopolitan influences due to better communication and transportation, by increased black resistance, by adaptation to new technologies and methods of production, and perhaps by still other factors. Consequently, after 1965, the South was stymied neither by emasculated cotton planters nor by non-existent labor unions. Hence, the region grew mightily. Economists have since debated the relative importance of regulation relative to January temperature, industrial shocks, and mean reversion, but there is certainly some truth to Olson's views. Holmes documented dramatic growth discontinuities at state borders, which can only reflect the importance of public choices such as right-to-work laws. In 1982, Olson may not have thought much about land use regulation, but subsequent work has shown that the growth of the Sun Belt, particularly since 1980, partially reflects the ease of building in America's less regulated southern and western states. But while the Northeast and Midwest seemed like unfortunate losers due to the Olson cycle in 1982, the country en net seemed fine. Perhaps New York City had become dysfunctional during the 1970s, but anyone could just move to Dallas or even Los Angeles. The country as a whole had plenty of scope for growth because there were newer regions that hadn't yet been afflicted by change-restricting regulation. Yet, since 1982, shocks with a different regional pattern have occurred that make the Olson cycle a national concern. The shocks of the 1970s, such as oil price hikes and the Japan shock from competition with a new manufacturing superpower, disproportionately struck America's old, highly regulated regions, as we might expect. The natural cure was to relocate to the newer, lightly regulated regions, and relocation was easy because few regulations restricted building in the booming areas. But after 1982, America's more regulated places enjoyed a positive shock, and America's less regulated areas got hit by a negative shock. The positive shock was the rise of the information economy. That shock favored the more educated, urbanized, and regulated parts of America, including San Francisco, New York, and Boston. The negative shock was the influx, and ultimately the tidal wave, of exports from China. That shock disproportionately hit the less regulated, less educated areas, precisely because those lower-cost regions had attracted industries, such as clothing and textiles, that fled the northern states before 1990. The Olson cycle didn't predict those two shocks, but they are also perfectly compatible with its operation. There are other forces, such as technological change, that buffet local economies. Moreover, one part of the information technology revolution can be understood as showing the Olson cycle in action. Since the mid-1990s, innovators such as those who created Google and Facebook have operated in cyberspace, which is a new region without the regulations that bind entrepreneurs operating in the physical world. According to this view, the Olson cycle predicted a decline in the importance of the old physical world, and a rise in the importance of the new virtual world. The natural response to these two shocks would be for Americans to move from the places negatively hit by the China shock to areas that were positively hit by the information shock. Yet this movement is impeded because the land use regulations of the older, more educated regions make low-cost construction impossible. Groups of existing homeowners have created strong distributional coalitions that block new construction. As of 2022, America is best seen as split into three regions rather than two. The Olson split between newer and older states remains in the American heartland, but the coasts are now set apart. Austin, Glazer, and Summers show that the epicenter of American economic dysfunction is the Eastern Heartland, defined as non-coastal states that were formed before 1840. The Western Heartland continues to expand, just as in Olson's day. A third region comprises the coasts. Despite its encrustations, it provides opportunities for its fortunate knowledge-oriented workers, especially those in cyberspace. As the Olson cycle turns, American dynamism continues to fade. Changing jobs or states is limited by the increasing need to acquire a state-specific occupation license. As new business formation falters, America feels more like a zero-sum economy, one in which warring camps scramble to grab enough public power to protect their own interests at far greater cost to those of others. The young see the public benefits reaped by the old and want something similar for themselves. Even their affluent members lobby for relief from student debt. New interest groups emerge with each new election, groups that channel public resources to themselves. One side favors tax cuts unaccompanied by spending cuts, and the other argues for spending increases without commensurate increases in revenues. Olson foresaw the future that is now upon us. Preface. It may seem strange, at a time when so many find fault with economics, that an economist should claim to extend existing economic theory in a way that not only explains the stagflation and declining growth rates that have given rise to the recent complaints, but also provides a partial explanation of a variety of problems usually reserved for other fields: the ungovernability of some modern societies, the British class structure and the Indian caste system, the exceptionally unequal distribution of power and income in many developing countries, and even the rise of Western Europe from relative backwardness in the early Middle Ages to dominance of the whole world by the late 19th century. Yet the successful extension or improvement of something we have found unsatisfactory is commonplace. The technology that was impractical or full of bugs may, after further development, become economical and reliable. So also economics, even when it has encountered increasing skepticism, may, with the aid of a new idea, help to explain matters it could not explain before. If we step back to gain perspective, we see not only the embarrassments of many economists in the last decade, but also more than two centuries of cumulative intellectual advance. I am fond of quoting Newton's assertion that if he had seen farther than others, it was because he stood on the shoulders of giants. If Newton could say that in the 17th century, surely the trained economist today, however limited in stature, can claim at least as high a perch. The economist is the heir of several thinkers of recognized genius, such as Smith, Ricardo, Mill, Marx, Walras, Wicksell, Marshall, and Keynes, as well as of the yeoman labor of many hundreds of intelligent men and women. Indeed, since the giants of economics usually stood in turn on the shoulders of their predecessors, it is as though the economist today were standing atop a great pyramid of talent. Why, then, have so many economists failed to anticipate the emergence of new economic realities in the 1970s and 1980s? Perhaps it is because, wearing professional blinders, they have looked only straight ahead at phenomena economists have habitually examined. This book attempts to show that if we take the trouble to look to the side at the domains of other disciplines, we shall gain a different conception of the entire landscape. In part because this study encompasses several disciplinary domains, and even more because it aspires to reach policymakers and students, I have worked hard to write this book in a language different from the one I use for articles in technical economic journals. This book is accordingly longer than it would need to be for the fellow economists who are my first concern, but I believe it is, with the exception of some notes and parenthetical expressions, also accessible to intelligent men and women in any profession. Luckily, most of the ideas I have come upon here turn out, once they are properly understood and explained, to be astonishingly simple. I am indebted not only to the economists of the past, but also to an unusually large number of generous critics who have commented on drafts of this book and the papers out of which it has grown. These kind critics are so numerous and scattered that I have added a special acknowledgement section at the end of the book in an effort to do justice to them. The foundations and other organizations that have supported my research are less numerous, so I can mention them here. The most important source of support for my research has been the economics, social science, and policy research programs of the National Science Foundation, the Innovation Processes Research Program, the Economics Program, and the Measurement Methods and Data Resources Program. Despite their slender means and the manifold demands upon them, these programs have provided invaluable support for the research that underlies this and my other professional writings. I am also grateful to Resources for the Future, not only for support and stimulating hospitality, but also for patiently agreeing to wait when I delayed a book on their concerns to finish this book. The Environmental Protection Agency and the Sloan Foundation have also been helpful, and the Lerman Institute, the Hoover Institution of Stanford University, and the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars have also put me in their debt with fellowships that provided some months of freedom for my writing. My thanks to the foregoing institutions are surpassed only by my gratitude to my family. A book such as this requires intense concentration over many years, and my wife and children have, above all else, given me the peace of mind that made such concentration possible. Since The Logic of Collective Action was dedicated to my wife, Allison, it is fitting that this book, a descendant of that one, is dedicated to our three children. 1. The questions and the standards a satisfactory answer must meet. Many have been puzzled by the mysterious decline or collapse of great empires or civilizations, and by the remarkable rise to wealth, power, or cultural achievement of previously peripheral or obscure peoples. The collapse of the Roman Empire in the West and its defeat by scattered tribes that would otherwise have been of no account is only one of many puzzling examples. On repeated occasions, the imposing empires of China have decayed to the point where they could fall prey to far less numerous or sophisticated peoples like the Mongols or to the uprisings by poor peasants in remote provinces. The Middle East provides several examples of such collapsed empires, and so do the Indian civilizations of Mesoamerica. Even before the Aztec Empire was destroyed by a small contingent of Spaniards, there had been a succession of empires or cultures, each of which seems to have been supplanted by a previously obscure tribe, its grand pyramids or cities abandoned to the wilderness. The pattern was not greatly different in the Andes or at Angkor Wat, or in still other places. It was evident among the Greek city-states at the time of Herodotus, who said that the cities that were formerly great have most of them become insignificant, and such as are at present powerful were weak in olden time. I shall therefore discourse equally of both, convinced that human happiness never continues long in one stay. There are many examples of insignificant tribes and peripheral peoples rising to greatness. It was not in the awesome Egyptian Empire that the Mediterranean achievement attained its fullest expression, but among the previously inconsequential peoples of the Ionian Peninsula. The empires of the great city-states of Greece were, of course, eventually supplanted by the Romans, who, before their amazing conquests, had been a people of little note. The civilization of Western Christendom, that had by the end of the 19th century come to dominate the entire world, sprang from the backward and chaotic societies of Western Europe in the Middle Ages, which were usually unable even to defend themselves against the advances of the Moslems, the Magyars, and the Vikings. The parts of Western Europe that paced the advance of the West were often areas that had previously been peripheral or unimpressive. The center of growth in the 17th century was in the northern provinces of the Netherlands, which had never been important or wealthy before and had only lately escaped subjugation by Spain. In the 18th and early 19th centuries, it was England, rather than the far larger and more imposing France, that gave us the Industrial Revolution. In the second half of the 19th century, it was the long quiescent Germany and distant ex-colonies in North America, rather than the British Empire at its apogee, that carried that revolution farthest. There will be no attempt here to account for the rise and fall of the ancient empires or civilizations in the manner of universalist historians like Spengler or Toynbee. If their disappointing experience is any guide, it is perhaps not even very fruitful to identify allegedly common patterns in the rise and decline of ancient civilizations or jurisdictions for which we have only scanty records. There will accordingly be no attempt here to draw universal inductive lessons from the historical experience of ancient societies. By contrast, the suggestion here is that the hurried historical references indicate how little is understood of the rise and fall of nations and peoples. If the causes of the collapse of various ancient empires had been straightforwardly explained, the way we explain the conquest of a small and weak country in terms of an attack by a larger and stronger one, there would be no mysterious decay to attract continued speculation. Broad historical pageants of the kind painted by universal historians are then a better source of motivation for further inquiry than for immediate conclusions. But if other evidence, such as recent experience on which there is unprecedented quantitative evidence, or presumptions from oft-confirmed theory should resonate with the familiar historical tales of the rise and decline of civilizations, then there would be a case for examining the universal histories in a systematic way, with precise questions and orderly procedures for weighing evidence. It is upon the other evidence that I shall rely here, and it is to this that we now turn. 2. The economic history of the last century, and especially of the years since World War II, has seen its own examples of rise and decline. They are not so melodramatic as some accounts of ancient civilizations, but they are no less mysterious, and the rises and declines are probably more rapid. At the end of the Second World War, the economies of Germany and Japan were devastated, and observers of diverse persuasions and national origins wondered whether these abjectly defeated societies would be able to provide themselves with even the rudiments of survival. As everyone knows, the economies of West Germany and Japan have enjoyed economic miracles and are now among the most prosperous in the world. The German and Japanese economies not only grew substantially when these countries were rebuilding their factories and recovering to their pre-war level of income, but also, and even more rapidly, after they had recovered and exceeded their previous levels of income. The problem of what we awkwardly but meaningfully call stagflation, or inflation combined with unusual levels of unemployment, has, on the whole, also been less serious in Germany and Japan than in most developed economies. The last century also offers remarkable evidence of relative decline. The most notable case is that of Great Britain. Since World War II, it has had one of the slowest growth rates of the developed democracies. Its growth rate has indeed lagged behind that of most developed countries since the last two decades of the 19th century. By now, the per capita income in Great Britain is decidedly lower than in most of Western Europe. In the past decade at least, Britain has also suffered relatively greater increases in both inflation and unemployment than comparable countries like Germany and Japan. The slow growth and other difficulties of the British economy have driven many people in Britain, as well as in other countries, to speak of the British disease. Within the United States, there are dramatic examples of decline and, at the same time, notable instances of growth. The states of the Northeast and the older Middle West, and especially the great cities in these regions, have declined substantially in relation to the rest of the nation and the world. The near bankruptcies of New York and Cleveland are only extreme manifestations of a general loss in relative per capita income and outmigration in the industrial states of the Northeast and the Middle West. Most states in the West and the South, by contrast, have grown rapidly in the last few decades, These reversals of fortune have not been satisfactorily explained. It might be thought that the examples of growth and decline that have been mentioned have been explained in the literature on the sources of economic growth. This literature is certainly impressive. Edward Dennison's estimates of the relative contributions to growth of capital accumulation, of technical advance, and so on, have been altogether constructive, while Dale Jorgensen and many other economists have made Herculean efforts to provide ever more sophisticated estimates. Yet estimates of the sources of growth, however meticulous, subtle, and useful, do not tell us about the ultimate causes of growth. They do not tell us what incentives made the saving and investment occur, or what explained the innovations, or why there was more innovation and capital accumulation in one society or period than in another. They do not trace the sources of growth to their fundamental causes. They trace the water in the river to the streams and lakes from which it comes, but they do not explain the rain. Neither do they explain the silting up of the channels of economic progress. That is what I call here the retardants of growth. The literature on the sources of growth helps to delineate another example of puzzlingly rapid growth. We know from this literature that capital accumulation, though considerably less important than the advance of knowledge, is still a major source of economic growth. Since new technologies are often embodied in new capital equipment, some of the residual increase in productivity usually attributed to the advance of knowledge would not have occurred without investment in physical capital. Any uncertainty about economic policy, and especially political or military instability so great that it creates skepticism about whether any investment in durable capital goods will be protected, will tend to produce productive investment. Of course, businessmen have a political incentive to exaggerate their need for stable and predictable public policies, but there can be no doubt that their insecurities can have some effect on both the level and the type of investment in new capital goods. Virtually all economists agree that events or even expectations that discourage investment or destroy productive capital will lower the level of income. Thus, societies that are politically unstable or often subjected to foreign invasion are likely to have less productive investment and lower rates of growth than they would otherwise have had. There will be more flights of capital and fewer investments in plant or equipment that can pay off only in the long run. Savings are more likely to be hoarded in easily portable but socially unproductive assets, such as gold. In view of this, the rapid growth of the French economy in the post-war years is remarkable. It is not only that France was defeated and occupied in World War II. In less than two centuries, that country has experienced some of the most profound and protracted revolutions in human history, and has gone through constitutions almost as though they were periodical literature, and has suffered partial or total occupation four times. Even in the post-war period, near revolutions and fears of popular front government brought some capital flight. Given this extraordinary succession of political upheavals and foreign incursions, why did France in 1970, the year for which we have the best adjustments for national differences in cost of living and thus the best real income comparisons, have a per capita income decidedly above that of Great Britain, about the same as that of Germany, and only a fourth lower than the United States? 3. France and West Germany, with Italy and the three Benelux countries, founded the common market in 1957. It is remarkable how rapidly all six initial members of the European Economic Community have grown. A glance at Table 1.1, located in the print version of this book, reveals that in general they have grown more rapidly than Australia, New Zealand, the United Kingdom, and the United States, all of which have been spared the invasion and upheaval that the six suffered. In some of these initial common market countries, growth was more rapid in the 1960s, when the common market took effect, than in the 1950s, even though by then recovery from the war had been completed and they had already caught up with some of the more secure societies. One of the questions this book will attempt to answer is why the six enjoyed such rapid growth. In the 19th century, There were also remarkable examples of economic growth and national advance that have never been satisfactorily explained. In little more than a century, between the adoption of the Constitution and the outbreak of World War I, the United States became the world's largest economy with the highest per capita income. In the first part of the 19th century, the German-speaking areas that were destined to become a united Germany were relatively poor. But after the creation of the Zollverein and the German Reich, Germany grew so rapidly that by 1914 it was overtaking Britain. In the mid-19th century, the Japanese were desperately poor and could be almost effortlessly humiliated by the warships of Western countries. But within little more than a half century after the Meiji Restoration in 1867 and 68, Japan had become the only industrialized country outside the West and one of the world's significant powers. Another of my questions is, why did these three countries figure so prominently in 19th century economic growth? There was a commercial revolution and considerable aggregate, if not per capita, growth in parts of Western Europe in the 16th and 17th centuries, followed by the Industrial Revolution that began in Britain in the second half of the 18th century. Some of this growth occurred in the northern provinces of the Netherlands just after they succeeded in gaining their independence from Spain. Much of it occurred in Britain and, to a lesser extent, in France after centralizing monarchs seized effective power from the baronies, manors, and towns that had enjoyed considerable autonomy in medieval times, and then began to eliminate local tolls and restrictions that stood in the way of nationwide markets. In the aggregate, these episodes of economic growth transformed the Western Europe that had been relatively primitive in the Dark Ages into a civilization that, by the 19th century, dominated almost the entire world. The rise of the West, no doubt, was due to a number of different factors, many of which are explained in the history textbooks, and it would be foolish to seek any monocausal explanation. The standard accounts do not, however, provide anything resembling a complete or compelling explanation for the rise of the West, much less of the specific advances of Holland, Britain, and France during the Commercial Revolution, or of Britain during the Industrial Revolution. Something important must have been left out. Accordingly, one of my questions is, what has been left out or overlooked in the conventional accounts? Or more precisely, what has been left out that is so crucial that we cannot get a convincing and satisfying account without it? 4. There are several further questions that may seem unrelated to the foregoing questions about anomalous examples of economic growth or decline, but these further questions turn out to be answered by the same logic that explains the notable instances of growth and decline. The first of these questions is, why does involuntary unemployment occur, and sometimes, as in the Great Depression of the 1930s, strike a large proportion of the workforce? Those who are not economists naturally may suppose that this question has been adequately answered long ago. Most leading economists today agree that it has not been. In the 1930s, John Maynard Keynes offered a dazzling and influential account of unemployment and depression, but now leading Keynesian and anti-Keynesian economists agree that Keynes's contribution, however brilliant and important it might be, assumes certain types of behavior that are not reasonable or fully consistent with the interests of those individuals or firms that are assumed to engage in it. In other words, Keynesian macroeconomic theory, a theory of the economy in the aggregate, does not have an adequate basis in microeconomic theory, a theory of the behavior of individual decision makers in the particular markets or contexts in which each operates. The non-Keynesian theories of the monetarist and rational expectations equilibrium economists do assume rational individual behavior, but these theories do not explain involuntary unemployment. Indeed, one of the reasons many economists do not accept these theories is that they implausibly imply that all unemployment is voluntary. This book shows for the first time how involuntary unemployment, and also deep depressions, can occur even when each decision maker in the economy acts in accordance with his or her best interests. As soon as we understand how involuntary unemployment can result from rational and well-informed individual behavior, it also becomes obvious how inflation and unemployment, which we once thought could not occur simultaneously, can be combined, as they have been in the recent stagflation. At about the same time that the ugly word stagflation was introduced among economists, many political scientists began to describe certain modern societies as ungovernable. The term ungovernability was used by various writers in Great Britain when the Heath government fell, as it attempted to assert the authority of the government at the time of a miners' strike. The term was used in the United States to describe the politics that led to the virtual bankruptcy of New York City. It has also been invoked by observers of the failures of several administrations to obtain the legislation or authority to implement most of their programs, even when, as in the Carter administration, the president's party had a large majority in both houses of Congress. The concern about ungovernability in the United States often takes the form of complaints about single-issue politics and the limited influence and discipline of American political parties. Thus, our next question is, why are some modern societies to some degree ungovernable? That is, why has it seemed that governments in some countries did not govern or control their societies as well as they had in the past? There are also a couple of questions that will not be possible to state, even roughly, until much of our analysis is complete, so I will make only an oblique reference to them here. One concerns what I have chosen to call the top-heavy societies, because of the unusual influence of the top firms and families in the largest cities. Such societies are most likely to arise where there is political instability and an underdeveloped economy, and lead to a great degree of inequality in the distribution of income. The last major question is a bit different. It also requires the use of a controversy-laden and ill-defined concept, so this question cannot be stated as precisely as might be wished without tedious length. In a casual sense, though, the question is straightforward. What makes the class structure more rigid or exclusive in one country or period than in another? There may be some ambiguity, partly because the word class is sometimes used to refer simply to differences in income or status, almost as a synonym for income brackets or educational levels. But here, the concern will be with any exclusivity and barriers to entry in a social structure that at least to some degree limit opportunities and countervail meritocratic tendencies. The word class is used in approximately this sense fairly often in Great Britain, and the model offered in this book has striking implications about one important aspect of the evolution of class structure in that country. Those who believe that class rigidities in the sense described could not occur, or would never have much quantitative significance, will change their view the moment they think of the Indian caste system, an extreme form of class rigidity, which has limited untold millions of people to particular occupations. The same theory that generates testable answers to our other questions also happens, quite by accident, to generate an explanation of the Indian caste system, as well as of class or group barriers. 5. Answers of sorts have been offered to many of the questions I have posed, and sometimes these answers are even established in the folklore. This is particularly true for the anomalous growth rate since World War II. The remarkably rapid economic growth in post-war Japan and West Germany, for example, is often ascribed to the wartime destruction of plant and equipment, which induced these countries to rebuild with the latest technology. It is similarly attributed to the exceptional industriousness of their peoples, while in the same spirit the slow growth of Great Britain is ascribed to the allegedly exceptional British taste for leisure. Perhaps because Great Britain has had an anomalous growth rate for a longer time, its economic performance has been the object of an unusual number of such ad hoc explanations. Britain's slow growth is often laid to the strength or narrow-mindedness of British unions, to the resistance to change or the uncooperativeness of British workers, or to socialistic economic policies. Others emphasize a lack of entrepreneurial drive and willingness to innovate on the part of British managers, establishmentarian, anti-commercial attitudes that keep the ablest and best educated people away from business pursuits, and an addiction among the British ruling classes for Concord-type purchases of national prestige. A common denominator of most of these explanations is that they emphasize some allegedly distinctive trait of one social class or another, or the rigidities in the British class system. That folk wisdom is not set out as a straw man easily knocked down. On the contrary, I will argue that some of the folk wisdom is partly true, and I will endeavor to provide an intellectual foundation for some of the popular suppositions. The point is rather to make it clear that the foregoing arguments, like many others, are only ad hoc explanations, and ad hoc explanations cannot be sufficient. One reason that ad hoc arguments are insufficient is that they are usually not testable against a broad enough array of data or experience to enable us to tell whether they are correct. Each country, region, historical period, and indeed each human being is unique in many ways. Thus, the fact that a country with an unusually high growth rate has this or that distinctive trait provides no justification for the inference that there is a causal connection. Only the British have Big Ben, and only the Germans eat a lot of sauerkraut, but it would of course be absurd to suggest that one is responsible for the slow British growth and the other for the fast German growth. No causal explanation can claim any more credence than the Big Ben and sauerkraut argument unless it identifies an attribute that explains a number of cases or phenomena or is logically derived from a theory that has wide explanatory power. Often, explanations based on a unique attribute of a country provide, in statistical terms, a sample of the size of one. They are equivalent to concluding from a single toss of a pair of dice that resulted in two ones that tossing a pair of dice will always result in snake eyes. In some other cases, where a unique attribute of a country is considered, this analogy is unfair. The unique trait may be present in different parts of the country in different degrees, or there may be enough variability or richness of other kinds to make an argument persuasive. This is what accounts for the appeal of the conclusions drawn in the better historical monographs. Nonetheless, only when a wide range of diverse phenomena is explained concisely can there be a compelling basis for belief. Another reason we should be cautious about ad hoc explanations is that, when outcomes are already known, it is almost always possible to work out an irrefutable explanation if one can use any amount or type of information in constructing the explanation. Even if there should be no unique attribute to which appeal can be made, reality is normally so complex and variegated that any cases with different results are almost certain to differ in other ways as well. Any two countries, periods, or significant historical events differ in so many ways that if there is no limit to the amount or type of information that may be used, then it will almost always be possible to construct an explanation of any differences in outcome by appealing to one or more of the other ways in which the pair differ. Unless the differences that are invoked also apply to other cases, we are again back to making inferences from a sample of one. It is because it is so easy to rely on the unique attributes or distinctive sets of attributes that are likely to characterize any human or social phenomena that we must insist that any explanation fits some data or observations beyond those from which it was derived. The seriousness of the shortcomings of ad hoc explanations is aptly illustrated by a set of photographs in a magazine I read as a child. The magazine article pointed out that some of those portrayed were convicted criminals, while others were highly respected citizens, and the reader was invited to judge which was which before turning to the page with the answers. Neither my friends nor I did well in picking out the criminals. The most villainous-looking of the lot, I seem to remember, turned out to be a distinguished author. Yet it was remarkable how often, after looking up the answers, we would discover the sneaky eyes or suspicious chin that was, or should have been, a dead giveaway. Now suppose that, after looking up the answers, we also received descriptions of the childhood and ancestry of each of the individuals. Would it not then also have seemed easy to explain why the criminals had turned to crime? This one fell on evil ways as a reaction against his severe and distant father, that one because he had no father, the next because he had too much of mother. Yes, the successful businessman also had a severe and distant father, but he did not repress his hatred. Admittedly, the successful artist had no father and a doting mother, but this was the catalyst for his creativity. Whenever there is some astonishing behavior, be it a crime or a great achievement or whatever, there is someone ready to offer a confident psychological explanation based on one or the other of the special features of the astonishing person's history. Sometimes there are several different explanations by different experts, but few, if any, select those who will be so aberrant beforehand. One should be as suspicious of some of the historical and psychological explanations we hear as of the discoveries of evil features in the faces of men who have already been identified as criminal. The limitations of ad hoc arguments also help to explain why the histories of each country and period are rewritten periodically, and a different story told each time. Part of the explanation is that new sources are found, new interests emerge, and better analyses are developed. But partly, when there is no limit to the length of an explanation and no rules about which of the infinite number of outcomes is selected for explanation, an enormous, if not infinite, number of plausible stories can be told, and it is mainly a matter of taste which of these explanations is preferred. Scholar after scholar can then write plausible book after plausible book, but none need be definitive, and there is no accumulation of knowledge of causes and effects. We can begin to have confidence in an explanation when a large number of the phenomena are explained, that is, when the explanation has power, and explained parsimoniously. Since it is costly to acquire and remember information, parsimonious or concise and simple explanations must, other things equal, be preferred. The principle of Occam's razor, that any inessential premises or complexities ought to be cut out of an argument, has been useful to philosophers, mathematicians, and scientists since the Middle Ages. But when the parsimony of an explanation is taken into account along with its power, it bears also on the likelihood that it is true. For one thing, if the explanation has both power and parsimony, it is hard to see how its author could have resorted to unique or distinctive features to explain the outcomes. For another, when a simple explanation explains a great deal, when the ratio of power to parsimony is high, it is improbable that mere chance could explain its success. As Charles Darwin put it in the 6th edition of The Origin of Species, it can hardly be supposed that a false theory could explain, in so satisfactory a manner as does the theory of natural selection, the several large classes of facts above specified. It has recently been objected that this is an unsafe way of arguing, but it is a method used in judging of the common events of life, and has often been used by the greatest natural philosophers. The pervasiveness of a theory depends not only on how many facts are explained, but also on how diverse are the kinds of facts explained. Darwin's theory offers insights into the origin and evolution of creatures as diverse as whales and bacteria, and this makes it more convincing than if it could explain only mosquitoes, however many millions of mosquitoes might be satisfactorily explained. If a theory explains facts of quite diverse kinds, it has what William Whewell, a 19th century writer on scientific method, called consilience. Whewell argued that no example can be pointed out in the whole history of science, so far as I am aware, in which this consilience has given testimony in favor of an hypothesis later discovered to be false. There is also a need to ensure that an explanation is not consistent with the evidence presented in support of it merely because those cases that happened to fit the theory were the only ones examined. There could, of course, be other cases to which the theory is supposed to apply that contradict it. Since it is usually impossible in practice to consider all relevant cases, the best approach is often to consider all the cases in one pre-established category or another. This rules out selection bias, at least in this category. Possibly, different principles apply to the category considered than to other categories, and this suggests examining other cases outside the test category as well. If the facts are not selected because they fit a theory, and they are also numerous and in very different classes, then it is most improbable that a false theory could explain them and, at the same time, remain parsimonious. 6. The listener should accordingly not accept the argument in this book simply because he or she finds it plausible and consistent with known facts. Many plausible stories have been told before, and often also widely believed, yet they failed to stand up. The listener should not place even a small degree of confidence in the argument here unless he or she finds that it explains a large number of facts in different categories and with such a limited set of causes or postulates that it is clear I could not consciously or unconsciously have been adding as many as were needed to cover every outcome I could have been aware of at the time I worked out the theory. In fact, I did not know some of the facts this book explains when I developed the argument, but unless the listener knows me well, he or she, as a matter of scientific principle, ought not take this claim into account in deciding whether my explanation is right, for those who do not know me have no way, even indirectly, to test the truth of my assertion. Finally, the listener should also be wary about whether the cases I have set out to explain are simply those that happen to fit the theory. Lest the listener think I have been excessively sporting in emphasizing the need for high standards in judging the evidence in support of my theory, I should point out that it has occurred to me that intelligent people will judge all alternative explanations by the same high standards. And almost all of the competing explanations are separate and ad hoc explanations of each of the many phenomena at issue, and often explanations that focus on some unique alleged cultural or racial characteristic of each country, region, and historical period. In the aggregate, these ad hoc explanations are anything but parsimonious, and even when they are partly right, they do not take us far or explain how the key causal attribute originated or provide much guidance on public policies that might improve matters. 7. Although we should not be satisfied with any theory that fails to explain a lot with a little, we need not, of course, expect any one theory to explain everything, or even the most important thing. Absolutely nothing in all of epistemology suggests that valid explanations should be monocausal. An explanation may be entirely valid, yet explain only a part, and even a small part, of the variation at issue. I am reminded by the pilot's announcement on the aircraft on which I am writing this paragraph that the ground speed of the plane depends on the direction and the speed of the wind.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.